What is going on, everybody? So this week is probably the busiest week of the season as far as doing my player evals go. So not a whole lot of video making this week, filling out the draft board, doing my scouting. Also, obviously, the combine this weekend, a big deal, a lot of entertainment involved around that, but also collecting some really valuable information for all of this draft talk here on the channel. So not a whole lot of video making this week, but I did want to make a quick video here about the 10 players who will improve their stock at the combine, or just 10 guys to keep an eye on this weekend as you're watching the combine. Not necessarily in any particular order here, kind of went in order of significance, but don't look too far into the actual list as far as the order. So number 10, and this guy, he does have an opportunity to improve his stock by running somewhat well, but more so, this is a player that has a ton of like bad reputation, just if you ask around scouts and stuff. And having lived in Minnesota, I had never heard a bad word about him off the field or his work ethic, and that is Tyler Johnson, wide receiver out of Minnesota. Just off of his tape and his production, top five-ish wide receiver in this class. Now, he's not a super elite athlete, which is probably why he's getting pushed down a little bit, but I think if he can run anywhere in the 4.5s, he might run a 4.6, which might, you know, put some more questions on his name. That would certainly help him. I think he's going to test really well in the agility scores, but most important for me is something that you're not actually going to be able to watch on TV, but it's something that could be circulating on Twitter and stuff, and something I'm definitely keeping my eye out for is, how does he interview, and can he put to bed these, you know, this notion that he's got screws loose or whatever it is, because he really is a special wide receiver and can get up into that top 10 ranking in this class, in my opinion, if those off the field concerns get put to bed. Number 9 is Adam Trautman, my number one tight end right now, and that could very easily change based on how he works out. You know, if he works out like a top elite athlete at the tight end position, like I think he will, he could very well cement himself for me as that number one tight end. But this is also about kind of other people's perception of these guys. I think Trautman could walk out of here as the number one tight end. And then number 8 here, Andrew Thomas out of Georgia. This is one of the most consistently hated on players in this entire class. He's been a rock at left tackle for Georgia. A little bit of work to do in like his deep drops and stuff, but I mean, for the most part, an amazing athlete, fires off the ball. And of all the things that people criticize him for, the one thing people say is that he's not a great athlete. And I'm just like, what film are you watching? Like, he looks like Tyron Smith to me on tape as far as his athleticism. So I think he's going to come out the 40 time doesn't really matter for offensive linemen that much, but similar to Andre Dillard did last year at Washington State, just really fluid footwork and just look like the kind of athlete that you want there at left tackle. And then number 7 here, this is a guy that again could rise or fall similar to what we said about Adam Trautman, at least for me. And that's David Woodward. And I haven't done my linebacker rankings or anything yet, but right now I've got him as my number 3 linebacker. But if he runs well, he's not going to run elite. He's not an elite athlete out of Utah State. But if he can be in the mid to high 4.6s, which I think he's very capable of, and then have really good agility work, he could climb up to that number 1 linebacker ranking for me, because strictly based on like his instincts and his versatility as a player, he is probably the best, most polished cover linebacker as far as his fluid movement skills and just his understanding of like zones and being in the right place. Like, he is just a really good player. Utah State, obviously a very good track record of putting out those types of linebackers as well. So got my eye on David Woodward. Don't need to see him run the 4.5s, but get into that kind of threshold range of 4.6 to 4.65, and we can really start talking about David Woodward as a sleeper in this class. And then Troy Pride, number 6 here, cornerback out of Notre Dame. Came back to school as a senior, but a very elite prospect, and he could run in the 4.2s. And if he does that after how good he looked at the Senior Bowl, he was basically the only corner at the Senior Bowl that looked like he belonged. I think we could be talking about Troy Pride bumping himself up kind of into that second round range, a little bit like Sean Murphy Bunting did last year out of Central Michigan. So I definitely got my eye on Troy Pride and how he works out. How athletic is he? That's so important at that corner position. And then number 5, T. Higgins here. And this one's going to surprise some people, because his big knock is that he's not a great athlete. And I think he is an above average athlete for his size. And my comp for him right now is Kenny Golladay. Kenny Golladay ran a 4.5, jumped out of the gym, had pretty good agility scores. Like, when you're that big, if you're as athletic as far as your testing numbers go as like most 5'11", 195 pound receivers, that works like really well. So I got my eye on T. Higgins for sure. If he can run, you know, I think he could run like a 4.49, 4.5. That's good enough for me. You know, DeAndre Hopkins coming out of Clemson ran what, 4.56? So I'm usually not big on the bigger bodied wide receivers, but when they are above average athletes at that size, I can get on board. So I'm looking for that with T. Higgins. Now, I've already got him as a top 15 player in my class. Note that, but I'm just saying that would really cement that if he runs well. I think a lot of people kind of have him in the 20 range right now. Wide receiver 4, wide receiver 5, I've seen. Right now I've got him at wide receiver 3. Number 4 here is Grant Delpit, and I've gone back and forth on him. Tackling issues are weird with him. He needs proper coaching. I genuinely believe you can coach a guy to tackle. If you're a defensive back, that's kind of the number one thing that I'm not too worried about, but it was definitely a red flag and kind of what pushes him out of the top 10. But if he comes out, tests like Derwin James, tests like, you know, those freak, Jamal Adams is another example, with that length, I think he's a guy that can really skyrocket his stock and get people to look more at his sophomore tape than his junior tape, because he was an all-pro kind of prospect in his sophomore season. And then a little injury-ridden junior season, missed a bunch of tackles, just wasn't quite the same, and he's really fallen. But I think reestablishing that heavy athleticism base there with him would be really big for him. And then number 3 here, Chase Claypool. And this is something I tweeted about a month ago. And I've listed all these like big, heavy wide receivers. And I was like, of these 8 names, and I'm not going to do it right here, but there's a bunch of guys in this class that are 6'4", 6'3", 6'5", 220 plus pounds. I said, of these 6 to 8 names, one's going to be a starter. The rest will be XFL players, and 2 of them will be tight ends. And we're finding out that Chase Claypool is going to be one of those tight ends, because no matter what he's saying right now, I know he's saying like, no, I'm still a wide receiver, blah, blah, blah. Like, you don't add 15 to 20 pounds to an already super thick, slow skill set and body if you don't plan on moving to tight end, because he doesn't really stand out as a wide receiver. Didn't create a lot of separation in college. Didn't stand out to me at the Senior Bowl. But as a tight end, I'm starting to get interested, because all of a sudden that 4.64 or 4.7 that he runs that doesn't translate as a receiver, you make him a tight end, you put on that weight, I'm starting to get on board. And I doubt he would climb all the way to like tight end 1, but he might become kind of that third round, like high upside pick at tight end that's really hard to find. So definitely got my eyes on Chase Claypool. Basically just for that weigh-in. He already kind of improved his stock for me. But how well does he test at that size, of course? You know, if he runs a 4.8, pulls a little Jordan Humphrey, I'm less intrigued, you know? And then number 2 is Henry Ruggs. That's who everyone's got their eye on. Now, he could actually hurt his stock, because this is a big confirmation bias thing, I think. You know, you got to go back to this time last year where he supposedly ran a 4.25. And when it's something like that where it's at their facilities, and who knows, like, it could have been his agent timing him, it could have been his best friend timing him. You never really know with this stuff. And his speed is real. It shows on tape. I'm just interested to see what he runs. My guess is he'll be like a 4.28, 4.27, but I'm not going to rule it out of him running that 4.22 that he wants to run and break the all-time 40 record. Now, if he is in the 4.3s, all of a sudden, he's going to dip down quite a bit, I think. You know, if he runs in the 4.3s, he's a good receiver. He's a good route runner. His hands are fine. He's pretty good after the catch. But, like, in this wide receiver class, if he's only a 4.3 speed, all of a sudden, he's going to get pushed back to the end of the first, early second, and, you know, that would be him hurting his stock. Because right now, you're seeing him in the top 15, top 20 most of the time. And then number 1, I just tweeted about this guy. It was kind of my inspiration to make this video, because I don't know how many people are aware of this guy, and you need to be. He's kind of this year's Josh Gordon, Alden Smith. Now, I don't think he necessarily has drug issues. He doesn't necessarily, you know, have those domestic violence concerns. For him, from what I understand, and I'm probably wrong about this, I didn't do enough digging, but for me, from what I understood, is that it was academic issues and then, like, being late to meetings and stuff. So there's huge off-field concerns with him, and that's Willie Gay, linebacker out of Mississippi State. Now, he is almost undisputedly the best linebacker in this class. His tape is flawless. Like, he covers, he flies to the ball, he's physical against the run. He said he's going to run in the 4.3s. I don't doubt that for a second. Like, this dude is one of the best linebacker prospects ever. But wasn't on the field a ton. You're going off a small sample size for his production. But obviously, there's a reason he wasn't on the field. So massive red flags. Is he a third-round pick? How old is he interview? Is he a first-round pick if he interviews well and runs a 4.3? Is he a undrafted guy? Is he like a Josh Gordon? This guy could go anywhere on the map. And this weekend is so big for him. Look, he's there. He got invited. They don't invite people with, like, character issues that have, like, domestic violence stuff. So that at least is in the clear. But all I will say is Mississippi State, they bring in a lot of, like, red flag characters. They do a lot of, like, JUCO recruiting. And just the work ethic and projection of players coming out of that school can be very hit or miss. So this guy, like, sky is the absolute, like, limit on this guy. But, you know, he could just not be in the league next year too. So definitely somebody you want to keep an eye on. Check out his, I mean, just check out his highlights before the linebacker comment. You're going to be like, all right, let's take a shot on this guy in the second, third round and see if it works out. So those are 10 guys to keep an eye on, 10 guys that will keep and improve their stock at the Combine. Hope you guys enjoyed the video. Hope you enjoyed the Combine this weekend. Cheers as always. Drop a like down below. Peace.